Ophidiophobia. Yes, it looks like we're back with the Christmas pageant, right? And we've got Lucy telling, no, not Lucy. Yeah, Lucy. Telling Charlie Brown, you know, trying to diagnose his troubles. What is his fear? But she did not mention ophidiophobia. Ophidiophobia. It is the fear of
snakes.
Right. Snakes. Actually, it's an intense fear of all kinds of snakes, not just the dangerous ones. So if you had that fear, and I brought a snake into the sanctuary right now, you would have to leave the room. And in fact, you know, this whole set of texts comes up every 3 years. And the first year I had these texts, I was, you know, only about here about a year, and fortunately Sylvia's not here today. I know Sylvia's been building stuff with Herman, and they've got a worker that only comes on Sundays. So they've got to get up early and do this, so we just missed the past several Sundays. But that Sunday I brought a pretend snake in, maybe you remember that, and she wasn't too happy about that. So she banished that snake from ever being in here again, because even a fake one was spooking her, because she has that fear. And you know, to a certain degree, all of us do fear snakes. If you saw like a copperhead or a rattler in the woods, you would probably do well to not bother it. I'm sure we all have snake stories about wandering out back or being in our own yards and seeing snakes show up. How did you react to that? Woo! Well, the venomous ones we shouldn't mess with, because they are dangerous, and if they bite you, you can be injured, you can even be killed. And it's perfectly reasonable to be afraid of things like that, that can hurt us, or kill us. Grizzly bears, I don't have too many of those around here. Black widow spiders, a lot in the Southwest. We had an apartment in Albuquerque where we had a whole nest of them right up in, as you walked into the house, and the apartment. It was like, okay, we should get rid of them. Who's going to do it? Did either of us do it? I don't remember. Rabid dogs, lions and tigers and bears. Right. Scary things we should avoid. But these are not the kinds of fears we regularly encounter. And if we do, we know we can get away from them most of the time. Our deepest fears are the things that come upon us in everyday life that we can't predict, we can't avoid, and many we even have trouble protecting against because they just happen. A traffic accident, a heart attack, cancer, Alzheimer's. Even for me to start listing these out loud can make us uncomfortable, because they have touched our lives, and they might bring back painful memories, or they connect with our darkest fears of what might lie ahead for us and for ones that we love. Some fears seem to have no cause. Other fears are so scary because they can be the result of human causes, of bad choices. Say, take my first example, a traffic accident. Sometimes they just happen, bad timing, bad weather, series of unfortunate events. Sometimes, yeah, they are our fault. And any number of ways we can be at fault. Just to be distracted when we maybe shouldn't be paying attention. Texting, yikes. But there's also drinking. Or perhaps, you know, running a life so intense that we don't sleep and then suddenly we fall asleep at the wheel. We fear these things happening, justifiably, I think. And then if they happen, we fear to have it revealed, especially if we are at fault. We try to cover up our mistakes, keep them from coming out, keep them in the dark. This is exactly what Jesus is talking about at the end of our gospel text this morning. For all who love evil hate the light and do not come into the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. Is this talking about us? Well, sometimes. But we don't love evil. We don't really seek to harm others. We don't intentionally cause accidents or beat people up or steal their stuff. So is this about us? Well, no, I think we can calmly and rationally say we don't engage in extreme forms of evil. None of us, but in the course of our day, we can do little things that we know are not right and that we would rather keep in the dark. Maybe it's a little thing like we eat things that we know we probably are not good for us. Maybe more of those things than we should. Or maybe it's smoking, or maybe it is drinking, or doing that a little bit more than we ought. Or we may say things we wish we hadn't said. Or we avoid things that we know we should. And our prayers for this season of Lent really encapsulate speaking those things out loud, bringing them from dark to light. Maybe it's reaching out to somebody, making that phone call that needs to be done, getting that chore done, doing some extra share that we said we would do around the house or around the farm or around the office. We also know that there's always more good we could do, but we don't do that either. We could be kinder. We could assume more of the good about each other than the not so good. We could give more time, more money. We could get out and see people more, visit people more often. And we could stop complaining, stop undermining, stop second guessing. But we don't. We don't. We keep doing things we shouldn't and not doing things we should. Even things we want to do that we know are good, that we know would make us actually feel pretty good. And what happens? The evil we do, big or small, everything in between, it has consequences. Just like the snakes that slithered in and started to bite those Israelites in our first reading today. The evil we do and the good we don't do, it all has consequences. The snakes of consequences slither in and they start to bite us. Eat badly over years and years, eat badly, the snakes bite us in the form of heart disease. Smoke too much and it comes in the snake of lung cancer. Drink and drive, and the bite can not only kill us, but others who have nothing to do with us. And yes, on a smaller scale, but no less insidious, actually. We can say something, a seemingly small remark, or an insult, or a rumor, or a cutting something to someone, and it's like we let in a king cobra right in the midst of our families, our friends, our offices, our churches, and people are going to get bit. And that snake we let in is going to turn around at some point and probably bite us too. Happens to you, to me, to any place, any people, really. But here's the thing. Sometimes the scariest snake is not the one that we can see. It's the one we can't see. You know, if I said, if I told you all of a sudden that there was a rattlesnake in here right now, but I didn't know where it was, and I was being serious, what would we do? Well, we might get up and run out. But just as likely, we might freeze in place. You know, afraid to move one way or the other. Be frozen in fear. That's what it means to be petrified. Again, another Greek word that means frozen like stone, like we return to stone or to rock. Paralyzed, unable to act, to do anything for ourselves. Frozen stiff, stuck, and scared to death. We know that's what fear does to us. It can keep us from picking up the phone, from saying we're sorry, from going over to a house, from working things out with people, because we're afraid of what they might say or what they might think of us. If we revealed something we did or allowed ourselves to be vulnerable and weak in front of each other. And fear can keep us from doing something like introducing ourselves to someone new. What if they don't like us? What if we say something stupid? Fear can keep us from going to the doctor for that checkup and finding out some truth about our health. Fear can keep us sitting on the sofa petrified, watching TV instead of engaging and going out into the world. It can make it impossible for us to even pick up our telephone. It can keep us from revealing our true selves, all that we can be, all that we have to offer as individuals and as a community, as a church. Keep us from all that joy and purpose that God wants us to have for ourselves, for our loved ones, for the world that God so loves. The Israelites were afraid. Yeah, those snakes were bad. And people were hurt, they were dying. And these snakes were everywhere. You never knew when a snake might turn up. And the Israelites were also afraid because they knew that they had brought these snakes on themselves by their own words and behavior, action and inaction. And they wonder, what will God do to them once they reveal that it was their fault and that they need help? What will Moses, their leader, think of them? Will he tell them to get lost and go find a new leader through the desert? Will God condemn them and give up on them? Even damn them for all time? Yeah, just let them die. No. No. Moses prays for them. Deeply engaged in their life on this journey with them. And God saves them. Now notice, God doesn't take the snakes away. The people confessed their sins, but the consequences of those sins remain. The snakes of consequence are still out there biting. We can still get hurt and get sick and face accidents and threats. But God gave an ultimate promise to save us, a promise of eternal life. And when Moses put that bronze snake up on that pole, God was showing that promise, really kind of beginning it for real in a very visible way, giving us a hint of the healing and the help to come. Because when Jesus was lifted up on that cross, as the window shows, the promise was confirmed, sealed in the blood of Christ, for all to turn and see and believe. Christ on the cross is God saying to you, you are now saved from your biggest threat, your ultimate destruction. You have nothing to fear because nothing can destroy you. You are mine. I have bought you with my blood, and I gave you my own life, given for you now and forever. So this is how this is supposed to work, okay? When you face anything that makes you afraid, a test you have to take, a phone call you have to make, a job that you're about to start, a day that you can hardly face, turn and look to Christ. This is why lots of people put crosses on their walls, especially near their beds. So when they lay down or when they wake up, they can turn to that symbol of Christ, who was lifted up for their sake, and say, God, I don't know if I can do this. I don't know if I can take it anymore. I don't know if I have the power to stop the bad things that I'm doing, but I know you do. I believe it. Lift me up and carry me through. Give me some of your strength, your courage, your eternal life today, right now, as I face dark, dreadful, even deadly things that might just take me down. Take away my fear. You promised to save me, not condemn me, not leave me alone and leave me in the dark. Keep me going. Keep me from perishing. Keep me walking in your light. In the name of your Son, the one who saves, we can turn and pray.